Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Courage of the Mountain Man by William W. Johnstone, narrated by J. Rodney Turner. Courage of the Mountain Man. Necessity brings him here, not pleasure. Dante. Those who play with cats must expect to be scratched. Cervantes. Smoke Jensen. He drifted west with his pa, just a boy, right after the war between the states ended. Hard work was all he'd ever known. After his ma died and his sister took off with a gambling fella, young Jensen had worked the hard scrabble farm in the hills and hollows of Missouri and just did manage to keep body and soul together. Pick up one rock, and two more would take its place the next morning, seemed like. Then his pa came home. They pulled out a week after the elder Jensen's return home, heading west. Young Jensen had him a 36-caliber Navy Colt that Jesse James had given him after the boy had let some of the guerrilla troops of Bloody Bill Anderson rest and water their horses at the farm. Jesse had seemed a right nice person to young Jensen. Jesse had given him an extra cylinder for the pistol, too. Neighborly, that's what it was. On the way west, an old mountain man fell in with the pair on the plains. Said his name was Preacher. Not 30 minutes after the introductions, a band of Indians looking for scalps hit the trio, and it was there that young Jensen got the name hung on him that would stay with him forever. Although only a boy, young Jensen fought a man's fight and killed his share of those who were trying to kill them. A thin finger of smoke lifted from the barrel of the Navy 36 young Jensen held in his hand. The old mountain man smiled and said, "Can't call you no boy now. You be a man. I think I'll call you Smoke." 1. Smoke Jensen stepped out of the cafe on the main street of Big Rock, Colorado. He leaned against an awning post and rolled a cigarette, lighting it just as Sheriff Monte Carson strolled up. "Need to talk with you, Smoke," the sheriff said. "You like a beer?" "No," the ruggedly handsome man with the cold eyes said with a smile. "But I'll watch you drink one." The sheriff and the most feared gun handler in all the West walked to the saloon, pushed open the bat wings, and stepped inside. Monty ordered a beer and Smoke ordered coffee. "I hear you're selling your stock, Smoke." "Most of it." "I'm going to raise horses, Monty. Oh, I'll keep a small herd, but nothing like we've had out on the Sugar Loaf." "You using the rails?" "I wish, Monty." "No, this'll be a hard drive. All the way up to Montana, into a big valley. Town's called Blackstown. Fell up there named T.J. Duggan wants the whole damn herd." "The whole herd? Why?" Smoke shrugged heavy, muscular shoulders. "Beats me. He's an Eastern fella. Said he was in a hurry to get into ranching. He's paying me good money, Monty. I couldn't turn down the offer." "How about your hands once the drive is over?" Smoke chuckled. "A few won't adrift, you know cowboys. But I couldn't run most of them off with a shotgun. I'm going to be running a lot of horses, Monty. You know how I love the Appaloosas. I'll be needing hands." "And when will you pull out?" "Oh, about 10 days, I think." "Why? You want to come along and do some honest work for a change?" "Hell, man, I'd love to. But no, we have trials set for all the next month." "Smoke, you know you're going up into Clint Black's country." "Clint Black doesn't bother me. I don't even know the man. All I know is he's a rancher who thinks he owns the whole damn Montana territory." "He's got some rough old boys riding for him, Smoke." "I've run up against some rough old boys a time or two in my life, Monty." Smoke spoke the word softly, but there was lead and fire and gun smoke behind them. "Clint Black better rein in his hands and his mouth when he meets up with Smoke Jensen," the sheriff thought. "If you aggravate him too much, Smoke will come after you looking like a demon out of hell. Both men watched as three young riders came walking their horses slowly up the street. Both men noted that the riders sat on Texas saddles. Without the wide skirt, the saddle horn was thicker and stronger for roping, and the stirrups were of the heavy-duty type. The brands were unfamiliar. All three cowboys wore their holsters tied down. One of the trio wore two guns. "You know them?" Smoke asked. "Never saw them before this day. What do you think?" "Wild and woolly and full of fleas, probably. Might even be on the prod looking for trouble." "They're young. Oldest one's not out of his early 20s, I'd say. And this place does have a back door," Monty said with a wide smile. But there was a hopeful note in his voice. If the three young punchers wanted trouble, Smoke Jensen was the last man in the world they should brace. He didn't want trouble in Big Rock, and if it started, Smoke would not have initiated it. But there would be three dead rowdies on the barroom floor when the silence prevailed. Smoke chuckled. "Then use it." Sheriff Monte Carson laughed softly. "I was rather hoping you would." Boots sounded heavily on the boardwalks and spurs jingled. "Too late now." The riders took off their hats and beat the trail dust from their clothing before stepping into the saloon. The one leading the pack slammed open the bat wings, and that irritated Monty. He looked at Smoke. There was no change in his expression. The trio ordered whiskey with a beer chaser. Their voices were too loud and too demanding. "Hunting trouble," Monty said softly. "They came to the right place," Smoke replied in a softer voice. "Hey," one of the riders yelled. "What you two whispering about over yonder? You talking about us, maybe?" Monty was sitting in a way that only presented one side of his torso to the bar. He shoved back his chair and stood up. His badge was now visible. He walked to the three young would-be gun hands and faced them. "The name is Carson. Sheriff Monty Carson." The trio stiffened. Monty Carson had been one of the West's premier gunfighters until he married and settled down in Big Rock. Everybody had heard of Monty Carson. "If you boys are looking for a drink, some food, and a place to spend the night, you found it right here in Big Rock. If you boys are looking for trouble, you found that right here and right now." One of Monty's deputies had seen the rowdies ride in. The back door of the saloon creaked. One of the young Texas toughs cut his eyes. The deputy stood behind them, a sawed-off double-barreled shotgun in his hands. He cocked both hammers. The slight sound was enormous in the now quiet room. "I'll take this punk here," Monty said, his temper rising. "Jimmy, you blow the guts out of two-gun over there by the bar." "And I'll take Tallboy," Smoke said, pushing back his chair and standing up. It seemed like he never would get through standing up. Smoke Jensen was several inches over 6 feet, with the weight to go with it. Huge hands and wrists, thickly muscled with massive shoulders and a barrel chest. He was lean at the hips and his jeans bunched with powerful leg muscles. His hair was ash blonde, worn short. His eyes were brown and cold. Smoke wore two guns, 44s, the left-hand gun worn high and butt forward, the right-hand gun low and tied down. He was snake-quick with either pistol. He carried a long bladed bowie knife behind his left-hand six-shooter. He could and did shave with it. Or fight with it. Didn't make any difference to Smoke. "The name is Jensen. Smoke Jensen." A sigh came from Tallboy. Slowly he let his hands drift to the bar, where he placed them palms down. "Fighting Monty Carson would be bad enough," he said. "A deputy with a greener makes it worser. Add Smoke Jensen and a body'd be a damn pure idiot. Drink your drinks, get something to eat, and behave. Monty told them, his anger fading. He turned his back to them and started to the table and his unfinished beer. No, Jack, tall boy yelled, don't do it. Jack was grabbing for his gun. The sawed-off roared, the heavy charges nearly cut the Texas boy in two, flinging him against the wall and leaving a bloody smear as he slid down to stop butt first on the floor. He died with his eyes wide open, staring into a terribly bleak eternity. I'm out of this, the third rider screamed. Jesus Christ, I'm clear out. Folks came running, for gunfights were not a common thing in Big Rock. Not with Monty Carson, Smoke Jensen, Pearly, Johnny North, and half a dozen other heavy-duty gunslicks, who had turned into respectable citizens, only a breath away. Dr. Colton Spaulding stepped into the saloon. He needed only one look at the puncher. Get the undertaker, he told the barkeep. Was that boy born a damn fool? Monty asked, pointing to the dead would-be tough. Or did he have to work at it? He fancied himself good with a gun, one of his shaken-up buddies said. Monty shook his head in disgust and walked to the table. Smoke had sat down and was drinking his coffee. What do you think about it? Monty asked. I think my coffee got cold, Smoke replied. Sally, Smoke's wife, read the letters from her parents and their children, who were all in France attending school. One of their children was there for health reasons, being tended to by specialists. Smoke had picked up the letters in town and had not opened them, leaving that small pleasure for Sally. Any word on when they'll come back home? Smoke asked. No. When do you leave? Probably next week. I'd like to take you with me, honey, but a cattle drive is rough work. I'll be fine here, she assured him. Just who is this Clint Black person? Smoke sipped his coffee for a moment. A hard, unyielding tyrant of a man. I suspect that somebody sold this T.J. Duggan a bill of goods with this ranch he bought. Somebody wanted out of that country and found themselves a sucker. I don't even know the man, and I feel sorry for him. Oh, my, Sally said, but with a smile. Her husband looked at her. What's that all about? I feel a quest coming on, oh, man of La Mancha. Sally, I gave you the book to read. He looked puzzled for a moment. Then a wide grin cut his face and softened his eyes. Oh, yeah. Don Quixote. She gently corrected his pronunciation. Am I the knight of the woeful figure? Hardly, she said with a laugh. But you do have this tendency to stand up for lost causes in the little person. You knew that when you married me, honey. She stood up and walked to him, kissing him on the cheek. And I love you all the more for it. Now, stand up and put on an apron, she told the most feared gunfighter in all the West. I'll wash you dry. Yes, dear. Smoke Jensen had not sought out the reputation of gunfighter. Most of the known ones hadn't. For several years after he and Sally were married, he had changed his name and lived quietly. Then outlaws come to town, and he was forced to once more strap on his guns to protect hearth and home and kith and kin. He never went back to his false name. He was Smoke Jensen, a man of peace if allowed, a warrior when he had to be. Back in 72, when he was just out of his teens, Smoke Jensen tracked down the men who had raped and killed his wife, Nicole, and had brutally murdered their baby son, Arthur. He cornered them in a raw silver mining town in the Uncompahgre. Writers of dime novels wrote that there were 50 gun hands in the town, and balladeers sang that Smoke Jensen killed 100 or more desperados. In a play later written about him, with Smoke portrayed in New York City by a dandy who had never been west of Philadelphia, Smoke was portrayed to have killed 500 men on that fateful day. In reality, Smoke faced 14 men that day. Smoke rode away, wounded a half a dozen times. The miners buried 14 gun hands. A month later, his wounds nearly healed. Smoke went after the men who had killed his brother and his father years back. He found them in Idaho. When he rode away, he left a burning town in the streets littered with dead. It was there that Smoke met Sally. No one really knew how many murderers, outlaws, rapists, and other assorted human slime had fallen under the guns of Smoke Jensen. Smoke himself didn't know. And he didn't worry about it. But the figure was staggeringly high. Around Big Rock, Smoke was known as a man who loved kids and dogs and horses, who sang solos in church every now and then, and would pitch in with a barn or house raising. He would climb a tree to rescue a cat, take in stray dogs and make sure they had good homes or keep them himself. There were at least 20 running around the fenced-in acres where the house stood on the Sugarloaf. He would help a stranger in need and had completely outfitted, at his own expense, numerous settlers who had lost everything in their march west. But crowd him, insult his wife, make a hostile move against an innocent. As Sally had pointed out in the kitchen, even an innocent he didn't know. Hurt one of his dogs or horses, and Smoke Jensen would hunt that man down, call him out, and either beat him half to death with those huge fists, or kill him. There is an old Western expression that men would use to test another man's courage. It reads, "I ain't never seen none of your graveyards." Nobody ever said that to Smoke Jensen. On this drive north to Montana Territory, Smoke had hired 8 boys who were out of school for the summer. 1 16-year-old, 4 15-year-olds, and 3 14-year-olds. They were young, but they were good hands. Willie, Jake, Bobby, Rabbit, Louie, Dan, Sonny, and Guy. In addition to his regular hands, Smoke had hired on 4 more men who had drifted through. He wired their former employers. The telegraph was making life a lot easier in the West, and received replies that the men were good hands who would give a day's work for a day's pay. That would give him 17 men for the drive. It wasn't enough, for the herd was very large, but he could pick up other hands along the way. The drive would be hard work for the boys, and it would also be an adventure for them. Smoke was kind of looking forward to it himself. 2. On the morning of the pullout, the boys from the neighboring farms and ranches were so excited they could hardly contain themselves. Not only were they going on a real cattle drive, clear up into Montana Territory, but they were in the company of Smoke Jensen. How much better could it get? The boys knew they would be close to the drag most of the time, herding the remuda on either the right or left flank of the cattle, but that was all right. It was a very responsible job, and they knew it. Smoke had figured it close as far as manpower was concerned. Some trail bosses figure 1 cowboy for every 400 cows. Smoke figured 1 cowboy for every 250 cows. They would be pushing slightly over 3,500 head, not all belonging to Smoke. A half a dozen other ranchers had put a number of their cattle up for sale as well. The price Duggan was paying was more than fair, so why not throw in with Smoke? The remuda was made up of more than 100 horses, so the boys would have their young hands full. Just before pullout, Smoke found 2 more punchers drifting through and hired them. They were down at the heels and looked like they needed a good meal just to stay alive one more day. But their horses were in good shape, and they had honest eyes and easy grins. Their hands were so calloused from handling cattle and ropes, Smoke knew they couldn't be outlaws. The cook was a sour-faced old coot with never a kind word for anybody. But he was the best trail cook in 5 counties and could be counted on to have coffee ready any time the men wanted it. While they were in camp, that is. "Damn bunch of snot-nosed boys gonna eat us out of grub before we get 50 miles," he had groused. "This many men, we're going to need another wagon, and I got to have me a helper, too. That's that, or I ain't going." "Will I do, Denver?" Sally asked, stepping up. "A female?" Denver shouted. "Hell no." "She's a darn sight better cook than you, you old goat," one of Smoke's regular hands told him. Denver threw his hat on the ground. That's a tooken bet, boy. Now wait just a minute, Smoke said. I run this outfit. I say who goes along, and Sally is not coming along on this cattle drive. The hands all gathered around, grinning like a bunch of fools. None of them would have missed this for a month's wages and a little speckled pup. She marched up to him. She wore men's breeches, and the men all admired that sight, too, but there wasn't a man among them, including the new hands, who wouldn't stomp any man who said anything about Sally's shape. Outside of their own bunch, that is, and that would be said very respectfully. I see, Mr. Jensen, Sally said, her head just about reaching the center of Smoke's chest. It wasn't too dangerous for me to ride all over Hell's Creation a few months back with a rifle in my hand getting you out of a bad situation. Now, Sally, Smoke said. Oh, no, that was quite all right for me to do that. Smoke sighed. Why, there ain't no way this little bit of thing could keep up with me. Denver stuck his mouth into the situation. And what if we run into quarrelsome Injuns? I never seen a woman who could shoot worth a damn. I really wish you hadn't said that, Smoke muttered. Sally jerked one of Smoke's 44s from leather and put all five rounds into the knot on a log some 50 feet away. She handed the pistol back to Smoke. Denver chewed his tobacco for a moment. What do you know about a chuck wagon, little lady? I wish you hadn't asked that either, Smoke muttered, reloading his 44. I know how to doctor cuts, drive a wagon, prepare 3 hot, she smiled, and tasty meals a day. And I know to point the tongue of the wagon toward the North Star every night. Denver chewed, spat, and grinned. You and me, little lady, are going to get along just fine. I didn't say she was coming along, Smoke protested. I reckon you didn't, boss, but I can see that you ain't the only one who wears pants around here, neither. The drive was delayed for one day while Sally got ready to go and made arrangements for this, that, and the other thing, as females are wont to do before a journey. Just as dawn was cracking the sky, the drovers high-hoed the herd and started them moving north. One of the boys would take turns driving Miss Sally's wagon, which was not a chore for any of them. Miss Sally was beautiful, and she smelled good, too. Only bad thing was that all the hands, men and boys, knew that Miss Sally had laid in a goodly number of bars of soap, like about 5 cases. And that meant that every time they stopped, if there was water handy, everybody was going to take a bath, whether they needed it or not. And the boys were looking forward to doing a whole lot of cussing on this trip. That was out, too. Well, they all could gather in a bunch and cuss quiet, they reckoned. After the second day out, the lead cows were established and the herd moved along. Keep them out of the dew in the morning, Smoke reminded the men. Dew tended to soften the cattle hooves. They would average 10 to 12 miles a day. The chuck wagons were new, both bought from the Studebaker Brothers Manufacturing Company. Sally had seen to it that the coffee beans were Arbuckles, which always had a stick of peppermint packed in each 1-pound bag. Cowboys had been known to come to blows, and sometimes guns over who got the peppermint. Sally straightened out that problem easily by buying a huge box of peppermint candy before leaving. Everybody got a peppermint occasionally, even Smoke, if he behaved. Sally and Denver worked well together, and the meals, although simple, were tasty and, with Sally along, varied. Smoke picked up the western trail just outside of Cheyenne and headed due north. They would stay on that trail until they got into Montana territory. Once they crossed the Powder in Montana, Smoke would cut north and west, heading for the mountains and the town of Blackstown. That final leg would be the real test, for the drovers would be pushing the huge herd over no established trail. Are we going to see wild Indians, Mr. Smoke? Young Rabbit asked. Smoke looked at the boy across the flames of the fire. He'd been just about his age when he killed his first man back on the plains of Kansas. He smiled at Rabbit. I'm sure we will, Rabbit, but it's unlikely they'll be hostile ones. More than likely they'll be begging for food. The route I've mapped out will keep us off of any reservation land, but not by many miles. Later, when the crew had bedded down, Smoke was having a cup of coffee with Denver. "You know Clint Black, Smoke?" the cook asked. "Not personally, only by reputation." "He's a bad one. Tried to hire me one time right after the war, when he first come out here. I wouldn't work for him." Smoke sipped his coffee and waited, knowing there was more. "He runs the biggest cattle operation in the territory. Hundreds of thousands of acres. He started the town of Blackstown. It's grown so much now that he don't control it no more. But he does swing a mighty big loop when it comes to town matters. In my opinion, this Duggan feller's a damn fool for going up against someone as powerful as Black." "Surely Black is not the only rancher in the county." "Oh no, of course he ain't. But the others is just hanging on. Black controls the best water, the best graze, the best everything. This is a story that's been played out 1,000 times in the West, Smoke. But this Duggan feller just might hold the joker in the deck."
"How do you mean?"
"Several rivers and some fair-sized creeks run through that part of the country. Black is big, but he ain't so big that all the water or all the best graze is on his holdings. Now, you say Duggan's brand is the Double D?"
"That's right."
"More than one Duggan, then?"
"Unless his name is Don Duggan." Denver smiled.
"Dumb Duggan is more like it."
"What's Black's brand?"
"The Circle 45. Then, brother, his hands don't hesitate to back up that brand with lead."
"If he leaves me alone, I'll certainly leave him alone."
"This many cattle coming into a part of the country Black thinks he's the lord and master of. No, he'll stick his nose in to see what's going on. And if he thinks he can get away with it, he'll take this herd."
"No law in that part of the territory?" Denver snorted.
"The sheriff is Clint's brother."
Smoke delayed the start of the drive the next morning. He sat alone, drinking coffee and giving some serious thought to sending the boys back home. Sally came over and sat down beside him on the ground.
"What's the matter, honey?"
Smoke laid it out for her. He never kept anything from her and was going to ask her opinion anyway.
"Well, the boys would be awfully disappointed. Do you really think this Black person would harm a boy?"
"From what I've heard about him, I think he's probably capable of doing just about anything. But it's hard for me to believe that a man who would do that could make it as big as he has here in the West. You know how Western people feel about kids. But all that means is he's either never done something like that before or didn't get caught. Maybe Denver is stretching the truth a bit. I don't know. I do know that I've got a contract to deliver this herd, and I'm going to push it through. Come on, let's go meet with the crew."
Smoke laid it out for them all. He knew what the reaction of the men would be, and Shorty put it into words. Shorty spat on the ground and hitched up his gun belt.
"Sounds like this old boy is meaner than a snake, boss. But I've killed a lot of snakes in my time. As far as him hurting these youngsters, I can't see him doing that. Western folks just wouldn't stand for it. No matter how big and powerful he is, if he ever done something like that, a lynch mob would string him up real quick."
Other men nodded their heads in agreement. Even Denver agreed with the majority.
"Especially if the boy wasn't toting no iron," the old cook said.
Smoke looked at the boys. "Any of you packing guns?" They shuffled their booted feet and exchanged sheepish glances that silently spoke volumes. "Get your saddlebags and bedrolls and spread them out right here in front of me," Smoke told them. Every boy had a pistol tucked away. Smoke took the guns and gave them to Denver. "Tuck them away." Smoke looked hard at the youngsters. "Boys, you know that out here if you strap on a gun, that makes you a man on the spot. Now if we're attacked, you certainly have the right to defend yourself. Your guns won't be locked away. They're handy if you need them. I'm going to squat down by the fire and have another cup of coffee. All of you talk this out and come up with some sort of decision. You let me know what it is."
Smoke chewed on a biscuit and drank a cup of hot, strong coffee while he waited. Sally stayed with the hands. Smoke's drive foreman, Nate, broke off from the group and came over, squatting down and pouring a cup of coffee. "Boss, me and Miss Sally voted against these boys going on. I think this drive is shaping up like trouble. But the others, they voted to go on. I reckon it's up to you." Smoke shook his head. "No. If the majority voted to go on, that's it. Finish your coffee and let's put some miles behind us." There are those who paint a cattle drive as romantic and exciting. A cattle drive is just plain work. Hot, hard, dirty, dusty, muddy, often dangerous work. If it wasn't too dry, it was too wet. If it wasn't too hot, it was too cold. Mosquitoes could drive both man and beast half crazy. Rivers and creeks could be no more than a trickle, or flooding over their banks. Waterholes might be no more than caked mud. But there wasn't a damn thing romantic about it. People have been led to believe that the man who rode at the head of the drive was the point man. Not true. That was the trail boss. The chuck wagon was to the left of the trail boss. The point men, always two, rode behind the trail boss on the left and right of the cattle. Behind the point men rode the drovers in the swing position. Behind them were the cowboys on the flank. The remuda was just behind and outside the left flank with the wranglers. In the rear were the drovers who made up the drag. It was the job of the trail boss to scout ahead for water and pasture. The other cowboys rotated positions. How often that occurred sometimes depended on the disposition of the trail boss, but usually it was left up to the cowboys to equally share the good and bad positions found on any drive. No sooner had the herd entered Wyoming than one of the point men shouted, pointing to the west. A dozen riders were coming up, trotting their horses. The riders didn't look a bit friendly. 3. Smoke rode out to meet them, putting some distance between himself and the herd. If there was to be shooting, he didn't want the herd stampeded. The riders pulled up and sat looking at Smoke. They were all pretty well set up, so they probably weren't rustlers. But they all appeared sullen, and Smoke didn't take to them at all. "We're from the Cattlemen's Association," one finally said, after Smoke refused to be stared down. His tone indicated that it was a big deal to him. Didn't impress Smoke at all. "Congratulations. Do you want applause?" "Oh, we got us a real smart mouth here, Walt," another said. Walt pointed a finger at Smoke. "You best button your lip, mister." "I wasn't born with a button on it," Smoke told him. "Now state your business and get out of my way. I've got cattle to drive." Nate and Shorty had left the herd to ride up alongside the boss. While neither one was a gunslinger, they could both shuck a Colt or Remington out of leather mighty quick, and they were crack shots. "By God," another member of the association said, "I'll not stand for talk like that. We're here to inspect your herd, and you best just stand aside." "Inspect my herd for what?" Smoke asked, his right hand resting on his thigh, close to the butt of his 44. "Been a lot of rustling going on," Walt said. "You're a stranger here, so we take a look at your cattle whether you like it or not." "I don't care if you inspect my herd, but you'll do it while they're moving. Now get out of the way." "Just who in the hell do you think you are, buddy?" another asked, belligerence in his tone. "Smoke Jensen." Those among them with any sense at all made certain their hens were in plain sight, and they made no quick moves. But there is always one.
"That don't spell jack crap to me,"
a burly, unshaven man said.
"I never believed 9/10 of them stories about you no way."
"That is your option," Smoke told him. He glanced at Shorty. "Get the herd moving. If these gentlemen want to inspect it, that's fine with me, but they'll do it on the move."
"Right, boss.
Shorty wheeled his horse, took off his hat, and waved it in the air.
"Head them out," he shouted. "He gonna sit there and let this two-bit fancy Dan Gunhawk get away with this, Walt?"
the loudmouth asked.
"Shut up, Bayless," a man whispered hoarsely.
Smoke lifted the reins and walked his horse into the group, stopping by the side of Bayless. He smiled at the man. Bayless not only didn't believe in shaving every day, he didn't bathe much either.
"What's your problem?" Smoke asked him. "Other than having to smell your own stink, that is."
"Bayless," Walt said, "close your mouth and keep it closed. I recognize the gentleman now."
"Jensen," Bayless said, "I think I'll just get off this horse and whoop your butt."
"Oh, I don't think so." Smoke pulled his hat brim lower and then sucker punched the man. He busted Bayless smack in the mouth. The blow knocked the man out of the saddle. Bayless sprawled on the hoof-churned ground, his mouth a bloody mess. Smoke backed his horse out of the group, stopping between Nate and Shorty. "If you gentlemen wish to ride along and inspect the herd, feel free to do so. We'll be stopping for lunch in about an hour. You're welcome to eat with us, and that includes the fool on the ground." Several of the men tried to hide their smiles.
"That's very kind of you, Mr. Jensen," Walt said. "We'll just ride along for a time and then take you up on your most generous offer of a meal."
Smoke nodded, and he and Shorty and Nate rejoined the herd. Walt looked down at Bayless, who was hanging on to a stirrup trying to get up.
"Bayless, I always suspicioned that your mama raised at least one fool. Now I know I was right."
Over lunch, which was the thick, rich stew sometimes called son-of-a-bitch stew, with sourdough bread to sop in it, dried apple pie for dessert, and all the coffee anybody could drink, Smoke asked Walt about Clint Black.
"I never met the man, Smoke. But I know about him. Runs the biggest spread in all of Montana territory. The Circle 45. Has maybe, depending on the time of year, anywhere from 50 to 100 men on the payroll. You're not taking these cattle to him, are you?"
"No. To a man named Duggan, runs the Double D spread."
"I never heard of him. I think he's new out here. He bought my whole herd and about 1,000 from neighboring ranches. Said he wanted to get into the cattle business fast. I've never met him. Everything was handled through lawyers."
"Getting to be a man can't break wind without checking first with a lawyer," Walt grumbled.
Smoke grinned at him. He shared the same opinion of most lawyers.
"Speaking of sons of bitches, have some more stew, Walt."
Walt laughed and a new friendship was bonded.
Bayless glared at Smoke, and hatred was fanned.
Walt gave Smoke a handwritten note and with it said, "You'll have no trouble in Wyoming. Just show anyone who stops you that note and they'll wave you right on through and help you with the drive for a time." The men shook hands all the way around.
Oh, but Bayless.
He rode out alone right after lunch. Nobody missed him until he couldn't be found, and a drover told him he saw him riding out toward the northwest.
"I hope he keeps on riding," Walt said. "Bayless is a troublemaker. Runs a little rawhide spread not far from here. There is a mean streak in the man that I never could cotton to. Shame, too, because he came from good stock. I knew both his parents before they died."
"How's he live?" Smoke asked. "That was a good horse and a fancy rig."
"A lot of us have wondered that," another association member told Smoke. "I ain't saying he's crooked, but it wouldn't surprise me to find out he was."
"And maybe he's heading back to Montana," yet another suggested. "He worked up there for years."
"Say, I think he worked for the Circle 45, come to think of it."
The herd pushed on, and for a time they had nothing but beautiful weather. The boys were turning into good hands, and it surprised everybody to see how closely they watched the remuda and how well they took to accepting responsibility. The days began to blend together as they pushed north. The herd was stopped several times by Cattlemen Association members and by curious ranchers, but the letter Walt had given Smoke quickly brought smiles and offers of meal and a chance to take a real bath in a tub. Something Sally jumped at.
"I've heard about you for years, Smoke.
a rancher said over a fine meal of fried chicken and potatoes and gravy. I figured you'd be a much older man.
I got started young, Smoke said with a smile.
Oh?
After my pa was killed, an old mountain man named a preacher took me in.
Why, say, preacher's famous. He took the first wagon train over the Oregon Trail, didn't he?
Something like that. Preacher was the first to do a lot of things out here. My teenage years were spent in the company of old mountain men. I got a pretty good education. The rancher's kids, ranging in age from about 12 to 20, sat at the long table, eyes bright with excitement. Smoke Jensen, the gunfighter who'd killed about a zillion bad hombres, was really here, and eating fried chicken just like everybody else.
And you and Sally have been married how long?
A teenage girl asked.
Well, Smoke said, you'd better get it right, Sally warned, and everybody laughed.
We've been married 10 years, Smoke said.
That's close, Sally said.
Your first wife was... The boy closed his mouth at a hard glance from his father.
It's all right, Smoke said.
Her name was Nicole. We were married, sort of. Had a bent nail for a wedding ring. We had a son, named him Arthur. That was Preacher's name. Outlaws came one day while I was gone. They killed the baby, and then raped and killed Nicole. I tracked them down and called them out in the mining town.
How many of them were there, Mr. Smoke?
A girl asked.
14.
Jesus, the rancher whispered.
Did you get them all, Smoke?
The oldest boy asked.
I got them all.
How old were you, Smoke? The rancher's wife asked in a soft voice.
I think I was 21. I'm not real sure how old I am, ma'am.
The father put a stop to it. No more questions. The young kids were off to bed. The women went to the parlor, much to Sally's disgust, while the rancher, his oldest son, and Smoke went into the den for whiskey and cigars. Smoke waved off the cigar and rolled a cigarette.
What do you know about a man named Clint Black?
Smoke asked. The rancher's eyebrows lifted as he was lighting his cigar. When he had the tip glowing just right, he said,
He's a bad one, Smoke. I'd say he's probably in his mid to late 40s, ruthless and dangerous and powerful. He took country that was untamed and built an empire out of it. He's big and strong as a bull, and there is no backup in him. It's his way or no way at all. Nobody is right but him. That's it. Anybody gets in his way, he just rides right over them.
Would he hurt a boy? Those boys I have with me, for instance.
Oh, I wouldn't think so. But with a man like that, hell, you never know.
I know he's run off nesters, but I never heard of him or his men ever harming a child. Hell, I ran off nesters till I got tired of it and learned to live with them.
You know anything at all about T.J. Duggan and the Double D Ranch?
The rancher shook his head.
Can't say as I've ever heard of him or his brand. T.J. Duggan. Don't ring a bell with me.
The herd slowly put the miles behind them. They crossed rivers, pulled the cattle out of quicksand, and fought the heat and ate the dust, and endured the loneliness of the trail. With the older men remembering how it was years back, when there were no towns along the way. When there was nothing except an empty, seemingly never-ending vastness, and then screaming Indians that came out of nowhere. It was bad now, but it was worse back then. About 50 miles after crossing the North Platte, they hit a vast grassland, and the cattle slowly ate their way across.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.